You're listening to the Neil Lampton Show, brought to you in association with Otium Entertainment Limited. Clearly not a Sisu subsidiary. I should make that very clear. Two very separate companies. Paul, hello.
Yes.
Neil, hello.
Hello.
Two games to talk about. A tale of two games. I'm going to ham-fistedly put that. Let's start with moments of the week. Paul?
And my moment of the week is just Liam Kelly.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay, Neil.
I think I need to explain any more, do I?
Moment. You don't, but there was it. But that perhaps you don't need to, but it would be nice if you did.
The guy's just... I think we had question marks over him last season because he didn't really seem to be doing... He seemed to be limited, whether or not he was limited by the system we were playing or by himself. It was always hard to tell. And then towards the end of last season, he sort of came to the fore and you were a bit more impressed with him. And then he missed quite a lot of the start of this season with injury. And he was someone you didn't really feel like we were missing. But since he's come into the side, the latter half of this season, he has been exceptionally good. And our man of the matches are just bizarre, just truly, truly bizarre. But for someone to get the man of the match against Bradford over Liam Kelly, who had had a sort of decent game overall, but we don't win that game without those two awesome passes. Those passes that, if that was a Premier League player playing those passes, match of the day would have done 5 minutes on them. They were that good. Both of them were that good.
If Lionel Messi had made those passes, we'd have never heard the end of it.
Thank you. But you know what I mean? It is one of those things where to play one of those passes was just brilliant. To play both of them. And the way that we huffed and puffed in the second half against the 10 men of Bradford, that was the one moment of pure class that just broke them down. And then by all accounts, I haven't seen the Portsmouth game, but all accounts, everyone's saying again that he was running the game, that he was magnificent. And the run of the second half of the season, I know there's players who've been getting a lot more plaudits for their performances, but without Liam Kelly, we wouldn't be within this chance of being in the top six still with two games to go. He's been absolutely magnificent since he returned to the side.
I heard you positing possible player of the season in Liam Kelly.
Well, the odd thing is, I think Dominic Higham deserves it. I think he, in a really odd way, where it's quite weird when you see lots of people on Twitter going, I voted for Dominic Higham, and you're like, I thought I was the only one who appreciated how well he'd done this season. It just seems like everyone's... I think he'd possibly be the most understated player of the year that we've ever had, because he isn't particularly showy. He's not particularly... You know, sometimes players win it who are obviously the top goal scorer, or when Mo Connaught won it, it was because he had a nice song. But he's going to win it because he's just been consistently good. And I think the thing everyone likes with Higham is you see that progression from that lad you weren't really sure about into being a very, very good League One defender. And I think Kelly is probably the only person who might be able to take that away from him now. But I think Higham's just done it more over the whole season. Well, Kelly's definitely been a second half of the season guy.
I wish I'd have seen your contrary face when you were getting ready to type out, I actually think Dom Higham has been the player of the season, thinking it was just going to be you, and then realising it was a popular opinion and being like, oh man, there's no point in saying it now.
Might as well go for an unpopular decision. I think Connor Chaplin's been player of the year.
Yeah. Okay, Paul, Neil, your moment of the week.
Came last night. Accrington beating Doncaster.
It's on!
Wow, it's just... Oh, it's just one of those where the more I look at it... And I think we have to make a distinction between predicting that something's going to happen and just recognising that it's still on. So I'm not sat here predicting that this is going to happen because I know stuff has got to go our way. But when you actually consider what's left to happen, and also the key part in all of this is that we have to play Doncaster, so let's accept that we've got to win that game regardless. It's all down to this weekend, isn't it? You know, just to give ourselves a chance, and that's all I care about. I just want meaningful games as long as possible. So that means we end up in the last week of the season, still with a shot, which is good because I hate when our games mean nothing. And I just know how really into the Portsmouth game I was. That had a real strong sort of feel for it. And actually, now having seen what's gone on last night with Accrington, I'm going to be a huge Oxford supporter this weekend. I'm trying to find a way and watch that match. I mean, it could all go tits up very quickly and then that'll be the end of it. But I am well into it at the moment.
I would say, now that we're two games left, I think you'd be hard pushed to describe this season, even if we don't go up, which I think we definitely will. This season's been quite a good success, hasn't it?
It's been good. I think we've had a good season. I think we can, if we don't do anything, I personally would say it's a missed opportunity. I think there's been a lot of examples where we've...
But I think it can be both, can't it?
It absolutely can be both. I'll always tinge it with, oh, I wish we could, you know, because there are so many games across the season where you sort of think, oh, we really should have won. And also when you get other opposition fans telling you how good they think your team is, you sort of think, oh, well, if only we'd kind of shown that more regularly. But yeah, I don't think, you know, you get to the last week of the season, you're still in a chance of getting to the playoffs, first season back in League One. As high as my standards are, I'd still recognise this as I certainly won't be booing them or anything at the end of the season. And yeah, it's been a good season that's kept me engaged all the way through, which is kind of all you can ask for, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think it is frustrating, though. I think if you... The thing is, we could and probably should be closer to Doncaster with two games to go.
Yes.
But I bet everyone thinks that, don't they?
Yeah, no, I accept that completely. And me and Pritchard had a discussion the other day. The problem is you go back and someone's on Twitter's asked, like, which game is the one that's probably... And it's not even which game, is it?
No, it's literally loads of them, yeah.
No, but it's also, you can, like, even just off the top of your head, Luke Thomas through one-on-one with only the keeper to beat against Burton, with that's 3 points. Or Luke Thomas through completely on goal with nothing between him and the goal to go 2-0 up against Portsmouth. And that's 3 points. And they're just two very clear. And obviously there are other, you know, I agree that sort of games ebbs and flows. But they're two absolute nailed on. You score both or one of those and we're 3 points better off. So it's not even like the game's turned... Death 2, where they play the same players through on goal, and only one of those is actually a player between him and the goal, and that's the difference between 6 points and what happened afterwards is no points.
Look, I know you think it's all Luke Thomas's fault. I happen to think there's many parties are to blame.
No, I accept that. I do agree with that.
I'm joking.
But what I mean
that's
is
a joke.
But you go back, and again, you can sort of say Burge has made mistake. You know, between Burge and Thomas. If those who had made slightly better decisions at slightly different times, there's points there that are just clear points. And it's just frustrating when this team, second half of the season, has clicked. But on those really critical moments, those key moments, the ones that can actually have a massive impact, are the moments where we probably haven't been as good as we could have been.
I'm trying to just make a really positive point, and you're bringing me down here, Paul. We're going up, all right? That's end of
we
story.
We are going up. My moment of the week is, I'm going to seem quite micro in comparison, is on Monday. It was Monday that we played Portsmouth, wasn't it? I enjoyed immensely a contested drop ball. As I haven't seen that in a game in quite some time. And it also gave me an opportunity to see the player who I think possibly in all of my in recent history is the player that I'd like to see contest a drop ball, which was Bakayoko. It was so aggressive. We went in for it. It reminded me of I don't know if either of you played at Cov Connection, five-a-side, and the way that the drop balls in there to start the game would effectively be like their hardest player trying to just stand on your knee.
Yeah.
Just what's it? It was him against Christian Burgess, and they just sort of eyeballed each other before, and they were like, let's see what you're made out of then. I thought it was excellent. I think you could almost do with some more you know, like more platforms for outright aggression during a game so that it's channeled into positions where sort of makes the whole game less violent as a whole. You just have little interludes where players can just lay waste to each other.
Is this a thing? I don't know. But in ice hockey, I know in the games you can have fights.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Is that allowed? Is that a fight? I don't know.
I don't know enough about ice hockey.
No.
But that's very much the principle of it, is what's it? Just every so often, rather than take a throw in, just let your two biggest fellas just have a bit of kick at each other.
Toilet. Have a go.
See, this is why, actually, when I was saying I can't think of many people in recent history, Doyler did flash into my thing. But I think that Doyler would contest a drop ball by poking someone in the eye rather than trying to kick her. Like, he'd try and covertly sort of lean in so the ref couldn't see it and try and something underhand like that. I don't think he'd really kick anyone like that, would he, Doyler? He's not a hard man as such, is he, so much as a bastard?
That's a really good distinction, though. Yeah, you're right.
Right, so before we get into, it feels like that's the main thing to cover from the Portsmouth game, so we'll see whether we need to do any more on that, but we will talk about Bradford first. So, Paul, you're going to start us off on that one. Where do you want to begin?
Kelly's first pass through to Hula. It's a bit of a strange game all round, really, because Bradford were pretty shit and they've lost, what, six of the last seven, five on the bounce before they played us. And they really needed to win to have any chance of staying up, and even that was quite slim. And they looked like they sort of didn't really know whether to stick or twist, because obviously if you're an opposing fan at the manager at the Rico, you know that if you sit, you're not likely to lose. So they sort of sat a little bit, but also they needed to win, so they were sort of in a bit of an awkward position. And to talk about Bradford for one final second, their right winger absolutely nailed the young lad at left back and really ran circles around him for at least the first 55-60 minutes and forced a really good save out of Lee Burge, and just looked a good player in a pretty average team. And to be fair to Bradford, they did have a spell in the first half where they looked slightly coherent, but then Hawula scored after Liam Kelly's three ball. And after that, it was just a case of how many are we going to get here? But being Cough, that just meant we missed chance after chance after chance, one of which was Bright hit the post. Another one was when Luke Thomas went through and should have squared it to Bakayoko, but didn't, and then didn't really have a shot either. He just Luke Thomas'd it. Then their player got sent off, and you were like, oh, here we go, because Bradford still really know they've got a stick or twist because they're 1-0 behind. And to be fair to Bradford, they just went, okay, we're going to sit even deeper now and just not get hammered. So we had 60 minutes against 10 men. We probably should have scored another three. Hawula should have had two more. He put one just past the post, had another decent opportunity. And then we made some strange substitutions where Mark Robbins is really keen to have Connor Chaplin in the number 10 role, which means he moves his best number 10 out the number 10 role and dropped Bright into midfield. And that really didn't work. And because Bright needs to be around the box, otherwise he does his little tricks, then passes it to the left back, and everyone knows that's pointless. So then Bright went to the left wing when he brought Westbrook on. Kelly played a beautiful flu ball to Bright, who was inside the area, which is where you want Bright to be. Right foot, left foot, bottom corner, 2-0. We beat Bradford, they're shit.
That's celebration.
Sorry, go on, Neil, you go.
I'm really annoyed with the cameraman because he didn't catch it. And I cannot believe how much hype Bright got on that celebration. Have you seen it? Has anybody seen it?
It's right in front of us.
Yeah.
The flip, so I didn't realize you sat over there, but it's just insane. I was like, where'd that come from? Because he hasn't done it at all yet. He tends to do these weird sort of jigs, and he suddenly does this almighty dance. And I was so looking forward to seeing it on the replay, and bloody high fellow cameraman, too busy focusing on the net rippling, which I don't want your arty shots. I want pictures of the footballer.
I want to pick you up on that, even in spite of the last three games or however many it is in a row, you're still having a go at Bright for passing it back to the left back. Do you not think he's got enough credit in the bank now that
he passes it everywhere as well?
He does that.
The thing is, there's no point. When you're playing against two deep, sat like a bank of four and a bank of four, there's no point Bright having the ball in our half. Why would you? You wouldn't want Bright to have the ball in our half.
Why is that the first thing? Why is that the first thing that comes?
Because that's that's the way the game went. The game, he moved Bright into midfield. And for that 10 minutes where we just, Bright was in midfield, Connor Chapman was number 10, was the 10 minutes where the game just died on its ass. And that 10 minutes was like, oh, this is just a trudge. And then he switched it around again, put Bright back in the front three. And then we hammered them again and we started tearing them apart again. It was just a clear 10 minutes in that second half where it was like, oh, this is boring. Because Bradford was sat there going, yeah, if I want Bright to be on the ball, I want him to be like 40 metres away from my goal. That's, if I was defending against Bright, that's where I'd want him.
I'm not
the
sure
last thing I'd want him is anywhere near my box.
Bright has shown so much from all over the pitch recently. I just
think he's better around the box. So you want your best attacking player, the player who can glide past players. Like that's where I want him. That's where he's been at his best. Tearing people apart and he's running at players. I just don't think there's any point with having Bright in central midfield. I just don't.
I agree.
I don't see the point. And that was it. And that second half, it wasn't an interesting game. To be fair to Brighton, I mean Bradford, they're not a bad side. They didn't look, Warsaw were far worse when they came. And they never lost like enthusiasm, or they never lost the will. They didn't crumple considering down to 10 men. But I think the substitutions just killed momentum for us. And it took two substitutions before we sort of got it back to a system that worked. And then we tore them apart again. But it wasn't, you know, I'd like to see us sign Bright full time. There's no denying there is a good player in there. But at the Rico, there's been spells against teams who have sat deep. And then we've moved him into midfield before. And it doesn't work. He doesn't impact the game. It doesn't hurt the opposition. And for me, I want him to hurt the opposition. He scored goals, he's created goals. So why would I want him deep? I don't want him deep. There's other players we can play deep. I felt a bit sorry for Shipley because he's not got many chances to play centre midfield. It was interesting to see how he was going to cope with having to break Bradford down, how he was going to move the ball. That was, for me, that was far more interesting than Chaplin coming on and Bright moving midfield. It was like, I want to see Shipley in this role. I want to see what Shipley can do in this game. That taking him off just seemed like an anomaly to me.
I think I know what you're saying, and I know that this is a different thing, but I do want to hear you say, like, be more praising about Enner Bakari than be like, yeah, I think he's all right.
I think the problem is, it's one of those things where you can go to home games and you see one type of player. You go to away games and you see someone completely different.
But I've been watching them all, and I agree with you. I think there's a difference. But you'd have to say, on the balance of everything, there was a point about 2 months ago where we were saying he's been very frustrating. And there's a point now where you'd have to go, all told now, all things considered, he's been an absolute revelation since coming in, surely.
He's been a good player. I'm not denying he's been a good player.
He's now on about 1 in 2 overall. I know what you're saying, but I just think you're being what you're saying is completely true. I agree with everything that you've said, but it also is to not say that actually just recently I think he's been fabulous. Neil, your thoughts?
I think you know I agree. I think
that's why I'm asking you.
I get the frustrations with Bright as well, because we all had them a while ago. I think my only point on Bright is we are not the same team without him. We're not the team that's pushing for the... I honestly don't think we'd be in this position, even close to the playoffs, without him either, because he destroyed Sunderland. He destroyed Portsmouth first half the other day. I know we lost the game, but he has that performance in him so often. And just recently, the last maybe month, 6 weeks, he's really turned it on. And the home performances are different. I think a lot of that is down to the pitch, and he said it himself, and a lot of them said it, where they just can't play the same type of football because it's just an atrocious surface to play football on. But he's just... I don't know his situation. He's out of contract, isn't he? he seems really happy here, but the idea that we could sign him permanently seems a bit far fetched. But I would bloody love to.
I don't think it is. I'd be fascinated to know how much money he's on. I would have thought that what's it? I think I have a sneaking suspicion. I've got no, not basing this on anything, just a hunch. I think he'll be coming to us because I think a player like that wants a manager who would say to them, "We'll build the entire team around you." And I think Robins loves him, doesn't he? And I think that Robins would say to him, "It's your team next season. We'll do everything around you." And I also don't think that would be a terrible thing to do.
No.
I kind of think he is probably above League One level as a player. Will only get better. Is young. Actually, you can kind of sense a bit of rustiness in him. And Paul, like I say, I'm not being a dick. Everything you're saying is completely right. But it's a little bit like saying, "Oh, this £1 million that I've inherited is a pain in the ass to get to the bank." You'd be like, well, "Is that really the most important thing to be talking about it?"
It's a case of you've got to use him wisely. I just don't think playing in midfield is using him wisely.
But I'm not arguing with that. I'm just saying, of all things you could say about him, the fact that you're saying that rather than saying what a revelation he's been, I think is a bit.
But as I said, it's sort of. I said I've only really seen him at home, and I've yet to see the brilliant player. He hasn't been brilliant at home. Now that's not to deny he hasn't been brilliant away, and against Sunderland he was brilliant from all accounts. Against Pompey for 35 minutes he was brilliant, all accounts. Against Bristol Rovers at home, he was pretty average.
Fair dues.
Against Oxford at home, he was pretty average, and it's a case of. You can only go off what you see. And I don't watch the iPlayer, so I don't watch the away games. And at home, he hasn't stood out as much as he has away. But there are other players over the years who sort of, we all know that sort of there are other players you see and go, "Oh, he's amazing." And other people are like, "I just haven't seen it." Some people have saw someone saying, "Jez, who we go with, has seen Sterling four times." And he's like, "I just haven't seen him play well yet." And you're like, "That, you know, he's been brilliant this season." But you have... If you haven't seen it, you just haven't seen it.
No, that's fair enough. I understand what you're saying now. I thought you were saying something different about the home and the away games, but I accept that makes sense.
And the other thing, I was thinking about this the other day. If Wolves had anything about them, what they would do is they've got the option to extend his contract by another year. If I was them, I'd extend it by another year and either sell him to someone like Cov or... sort of basically just sort of give him away for like 100 grand, but put in like, "We'll buy him back for 3 million, or, you know, we get first dibs on if you sell him, or we have a 40% sell on clause." Because if he came back to Cov and for the whole season did what he's done this for us at the end of the season, you can see a player who, whether or not he would ever make it in the Prem is a different argument, but you can see a player there that someone would spend money on, and quite probably if he had a really good season and got 10 goals and 10 assists and played like the way he has done at time for us, you could see a team in the Championship spending 5 million on him. And, you know, we got 1 million for McNulty, who had only scored in League Two. You just think, well, if Wolves had any sense, they wouldn't release him, but what they would do is they'd sell him dirt cheap because they're not going to use him in the Premier, you know, he's not Premier League ready at the moment. But you'd have thought that, like, that's just business acumen, isn't it? That's what Real Madrid and Barcelona do all the time, where they sell someone for shit, but have a sort of buy-in clause, or Barcelona did it with De La Fete, and they sold him to... Yeah, yeah. And it's like, okay, we'll have first dibs. If he becomes the player, you know, he's ours for 3 million, but if you sell him to someone else, he's got to be 10 or whatever. But I can see why everyone likes him. I'm not saying he's a bad player. I'm just saying that, if anything, we need to work out a way of getting him to be that influential at home. I just don't think playing him in midfield is that way of doing it. I mean, the other thing was, you know, he was just we are where we are with two games to go. You know, it would have been nice if we'd have spanked Bradford because they had 10 men and we really need the goal difference, but it was an all right performance. No one really, you know, I don't know how Tom Davis got man of the match. I don't understand man of the match at Cov at the best of times. And, you know, we moved on to the Portsmouth game, which was sort of far, I suppose, that set us up for the Portsmouth game, didn't it?
If only there was a decent segue that I could have farmed out of what you've just said there, but seeing that there wasn't. Neil, do you want to move on to the Portsmouth game?
I shall do that. Yes. I was quite nervous before the Portsmouth game, because obviously we had it in our minds what we needed to do. We needed to win all three games to give us an even a slim chance of making the playoffs. So this felt big, and obviously it was on Sky and everything. So there's always that sort of hoopla around it, and it was all set up to be a really good contest, because I think what we've shown recently is that we are a good team away from home. Something about nicer surfaces seems to go well for us. And we went team wise, we've got a fairly settled kind of identity now. So we've had to tweak things slightly. Like Paul said, McCallum came in the game before, and I think it's fair to say he really struggled in the first half against Scannell, but both based on kind of sort of circumstance and the fact that he kind of grew into the game a little bit more. He acquitted himself quite well in the second half, but it made total sense to bring back Mason for the Portsmouth game, and who I think actually had a decent season himself as well. And obviously Shipley playing again in midfield, who for the 60 minutes in the Bradford game that he played, I thought he did a really good job. He was looking very, very comfortable. Very confident, so I was pleased to see him. And actually, again in the Portsmouth game, I thought he put in another really assured performance alongside Kelly. Like, my worry when Bayless got injured was that we just would lack any sort of dynamism in the middle of the park. And actually, when you see Kelly, how sort of ferocious he is throughout the whole match, and then there's a little bit of swagger about Shipley, which I didn't know he had, and he's shown that quite a lot recently, where he's kind of dropping his shoulder, dragging the ball back. He wasn't the only one to keep slipping, but he was slipping over quite a bit. And you kind of think, well, is that a mistake, him slipping? It's just unfortunate, really. I don't know what was going on, but he did slip a few times. But I thought he had a good game. And we started really well, and we just looked incredible. And I always get a little bit worried when I'm watching it on TV, especially national TV, because they've got their own agenda, it seems, from the outset. They've done a little bit of research, and they've got a bit of focus. And you always think, oh, are they going to persuade me a certain way? But even if you looked at that match in isolation, you didn't listen to anything that they were saying, which was basically really positive about our front four, you could see why. It's a real strange front four, where a few weeks ago, or maybe 6 weeks ago, you'd look at that and it didn't quite feel very good. You kind of felt like Bakayoko was there because we had no other option. Huula wasn't really showing much. He was doing the occasional, good thing. And Thomas was kind of drifting out of things. And again, we weren't entirely sure what Inna Bakari was. The other day, they were just absolutely insanely threatening for all of them, like just drifting in and out. But Inna Bakari thinks he's incredible now, to be fair, he is. Bakayoko realises that his main strength is charging down everybody in as and when he can, and it works for him all the time. He just puts them under so much pressure. And Huula, who has just found his kind of role in the team. I don't think he's a striker, and so he shouldn't be playing up front. And I don't necessarily think he's always as evolved as he maybe could be for someone who's got quite a lot, got kind of the talent you think he has got. But when he is involved, and when he kind of links up with his mates around him, those attacking four, he's a threat. And he scored a really good goal. And Bakari doing his thing, dropping his shoulder, slotting the ball through, and it was just a really good instinctive finish. And how many is that for Huula now for the season?
It's like, is it 13?
12. 12 in the league.
12 for someone league. Who's played on the left wing, I mean, fair play to him.
It's great return, yeah.
Exactly, and it's one of those people where a few weeks back I put Thomas ahead of him in terms of performance of the season, and even pound for pound I still probably would. But to play on the left wing and score 13 goals, even if you just dropping in and out, they've been invaluable to us. I mean, you've just got to take your hat off to the guy and say, he probably could have had a whole lot more, but 13 for him, I'm pretty sure he would expect maybe 10 if he could help it this season. So fair play to him.
Well, 12 in 12 different matches as well.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I asked Jim Brown, who was the last player to get double figures without scoring two in a game, and the last player was Musa, who got 13.
Oh, right, yeah.
In total, without scoring two in a game. Yeah, we had the discussion about Huula and Thomas not that long ago. I agree. one point was never that he's sort of a magnificent in terms of his involvement, but the thing is, when he is involved, something seems to happen, and he keeps, I think he's got 3 in his last 4.
You told me he's got 7 in his last 13, is that right?
Yeah, something like that. So basically, since Bright's arrived and since Bakayoko's been up front with him, since that front four has been together, he's averaging basically a goal every other game, which I think I sort of said this before. I think at this level, you can get away with a player who's not particularly involved but scores goals, and you know, he does track up. You know, he's not Luke Thomas, he's not as involved as much as Luke Thomas, he doesn't track back and help out. Like, he does move back, but you don't see him winning tackles or anything. He's more of a person who puts his sort of, he stands in the way and hopes the ball hits him rather than tries to influence the game by tackling or anything. But at the end of the day, he's scoring goals. He is our top goal scorer. He hasn't played every game. He hasn't played in the position he probably wants to be in. But when that opportunity came to him against Portsmouth, the same as the opportunity came to him, and they're not easy chances he's putting away. The one against Bradford, he's got to beat a man. The one against Portsmouth, he's, you know, he ends up on his arse. He's played through, but it's not the easiest chance to get on the end of. And he's putting him in the back of the net. The same against Sunderland, I think.
A lot of the goals he's got recently as well is because he's just fucking hit it.
Yeah.
So actually, all of that stuff that we've moaned about in the last few months about, can we not just have a shot? He is one of the few players that routinely doesn't try and walk it into the net, does he? A lot of his goals have come where they've hit the keeper or they've, do you know what I mean? They're not clean finishes, but he hits them first time and he hits them good enough and hard enough that they're either on target, bounce in, bounce out and go get a corner four. I just like a player like that, that just hits it, that just has a go. And you think, we've talked about it over and over again, I don't think, especially recently, and possibly because of the quality of ball improving since Enner Bakari's come in, but that he's a player in real form, isn't he? And we were talking about the fact that he's playing off the left. You wonder whether this is credit to Robbins for, we've talked about his ability to improve players as the season goes on and after he spent some time with them. Maybe we give Robin some credit for saying, actually, this is the product of working with someone for a while, and that he goes into next season as an absolute stick-on, first-choice, you know, left-sided wide player. That we, you know, we then build a team. Like, there's obviously players to replace, but he's certainly not one of them, is he?
And I think, my final point on Hawula is, you could sort of gauge people's opinion on Hawula by the fact that it's not often that your top goal scorer isn't talked about by virtually anyone as being player of the year. And literally no one's mentioning Hawula as player of the year. I think it'd be a massive shock if Hawula was player of the year. So he's sort of had an odd season in terms of, he's sort of underappreciated in his impact on the side. That run of 7-12 or 7-13 is a really impressive run. It really, again, another player who has come to the fore in this playoff race, I suppose, is the best way of describing it. Yet isn't a person who you see ever get man of the match, get very little comment after the games. He's not someone who's hardly talked of by Cov fans on sort of Twitter and things, not that I've seen. He's sort of flying under the radar, yet is critical to the way we play.
Neil, what are you going to say?
It's almost, it's kind of along those lines, really. So I think it has been just over the last couple of months. I mean, we did a podcast a while back, I think it was in February, and we were talking about what was required to kind of get us into the playoffs. And we were talking about, you need playoff form, and we wanted a steady sort of team to kind of see it through. And you've kind of got to, you definitely have to give Robbins credit for sticking to his guns. I mean, there were periods in that kind of early Enner Bakari period where we weren't too sure who he was, what he was trying to do, and what he was, you know, how he fitted into the team. And it just seems over the course of time, each of those connections between him and Hawula and Bakayoko and the people behind him, they've all started to appreciate each other, and they've all started to work together with each other. And it may have only been the last 6, 7, 8 weeks with Hawula, but like Paul said, he's another one who's just becoming so important. And I think it's also quite sort of just symbolic of almost how many chances we are now creating as a team. And that comes with both the frustration frustrations of the fact that we should be battering teams, most teams. I mean, Bradford, we should have actually smashed them. I think Portsmouth, we could have got two or three really in the first half, and we're not, which is, it is frustrating, because as a kind of a broad team, you're like, yeah, this is now clicking. You feel totally comfortable in what they're capable of. But we only, aside from Sunderland, they're not getting the goals they should be getting. But I think the other part of that is they're at least, you know, they will get a goal. We always feel like we've got a goal in us in some form. And even Hwulu, while he was missing chances earlier on in the season, now if he gets a chance, I think, I mean, again, he'll need a few usually, but he'll get two or three in the game. But he always seems to put it in the back of the net, because it just seems to have changed his approach, like a load of them have in the second half of the season. So it's good for us. I'm just pleased that I really like feeling comfortable watching the team, just knowing kind of what they can do. And earlier in the season, and this is just kind of the nature of football, isn't it? When you're trying to pick out the right players and the right sort of formation and everything, and eventually you stumble across something, or you hope that you stumble across something that works. We just seem to have stumbled across something that works at absolutely the right time. And that is why we were able to give Portsmouth, who were one of the better teams I've seen in this league, we gave them a really good game. It's just a shame that's kind of a second half. I don't think we lost our way. We didn't quite push it as much as maybe we could have done.
They also made that double change at half time, didn't they? And I thought Curtis was very, very good when he came on and offered them the level of threat that they'd had down the right, down the left. And I just think we pride ourselves on the fact that we do better when teams come at us. I just thought they came at us with a level of quality that we couldn't quite keep up with. And I think despite that, ultimately it was two goals that were easily preventable again, weren't they, that did us. And it wasn't, I think if we'd have, this is going to sound like I'm going back on myself, but that I wouldn't blame our performance necessarily. I came out of that quite positive. I thought there were spells, even in the second half, where we looked like we were trying to control and contain the game and doing an okay job of it. And we let ourselves down again by the fact that Lee Burgess switched off in the last few months and that we can't defend corners. And they feel to me like they are quite solvable problems, possibly by the same person.
I don't get the blame for Lee Burgess for the first goal.
I don't think it's for the first goal.
And he's headed it in from
the second, yeah.
Yeah, for the first one, it's a great corner.
Yeah.
No keeper in the world's going for that ball. I don't care.
I've totally blanked. What's this goal?
The first one's basically a corner.
Yeah,
he's whipped it to like the edge of the 6 yard box, and the guy's got a free header 6 yards out.
Yeah, it's poor marking for me. I don't think it's Burgess' fault. Yeah.
And I've seen people, it's like Burgess again. It's like, I don't know who you think's going to go for that. Like, yeah, the second one, Burgess fucked up. You know, I think Burge would accept that. The first one, if you're blaming Burge for the first one, you've got hatred issues with Burge. It's like, that's whoever is in goal for Kov on that corner concede to that goal. As you say, it's down to the marking again, because we continually let strikers or midfielders or defenders from the opposing team have free headers from 6 yards. We've discussed this in the past. I don't blame the goalkeeper for not coming for that ball. That's got to be sorted out by organisation and leadership.
Yeah, and that's my biggest issue with that second half was not that I didn't think Portsmouth played well, because I think they actually looked a very good team, and I thought it was just a really good game to watch. Actually, I quite enjoyed two, I'm going to call it a quality side, two quality sides going at it and having a good go. But what really annoys me is when teams don't earn their goals. And this happened against Sunderland, where pretty much every single one of their goals was almost handed to them, either through a deflection or just through kind of really kind of tame defending. And that's what got me, because while overall we defended okay for most of the game on Monday, it's just these mistakes or these errors or these lacks of concentration where you sort of think they really haven't earned those specific goals. They were a good team, but we gave them the goals which allowed them to come back into the match, and the Burge one is obviously crucial, and it would be remiss of us not to mention Burge again. I know we've had this conversation quite a few times, but you kind of wonder, like, where do you go with this? Because it's one of those where I think we know when Lee Burge is playing his best and when his head's right and everything. He's a good goalkeeper, and he was a great goalkeeper for last year, and he was had a really good start to this campaign. Something's gone wrong. I think we can all attribute it to that major mistake against Walsall. Since that point, he's lacked a lot of authority, and he's now making the same mistake over and over. And we've got a question, going ahead on questions, but someone has asked us, do we think it's down to sort of training? And my sort of answer to that is, surely we must all agree that in training, Lee Burge is catching hundreds of balls a day. He's not practicing this skill. It's there. It's got to be inherent. And yet, when it comes to kind of key moments where there's any sort of pressure on him in matches, he can't seem to get it right at the moment. Or at least he's liable to these big mistakes, which is, to me, it just upsets me, because I still know what he is capable of. But at the same point, I'm really kind of frustrated, because it's cost us points again. And it's not the first time his mistakes have cost us points. And the other frustration is that it doesn't seem that we've got an alternative, or at least Robbins doesn't want to offer an alternative to give Burge just some time out to kind of reset. We just haven't to keep throwing him in, putting ourselves at risk as a team, because he's not quite right yet, and also not really helping him.
Neil, any final thoughts on Portsmouth?
I think just one quick, we just need to kind of pick up on Tom Davis. So obviously he was almost hauled off in the second half to get Willis back in. Davis didn't seem too happy about it, kind of chucked his shirt away. From what I could tell, or I could be judging, sort of reading into this too much, but it seemed to be like Robbins, a reaction to a couple of slips and a few sort of poor bits of play from Davis, and he kind of almost, Robbins couldn't wait to get Willis back on the pitch, which was a bit damning, I would suggest. And I think it's very obvious that Willis is going to be back in the first team in the next game,
Which almost feels a bit needless, given that he's in all likelihood not going to be here next season, does it?
I don't think Davis is either. I mean, let's be honest, if Davis was, they probably would have done something with his contract by now. I think one of the reasons, and this is going to sound utterly mad, but I think one of the reasons that he prefers Willis is because Willis is better at using the ball. And I think that's Davis's biggest flaw.
That really is mad, because
I disagree with that. I think he's got a good long passer, yeah.
I disagree. I think he can kick a ball a long way, sometimes it lands on the pitch, sometimes it doesn't. Glenn Hoddle was a magnificent long passer of the ball. Don Davis is someone who kicks it in the general direction and hopes that, dear God, it doesn't go out of play. And against Bradford, a couple of times he sort of dwelt on the ball a bit too long, but they were Bradford and they were shit. I can imagine against a team who are got strikers you're slightly scared of, that you'd be slightly loath to have him in that situation. Hmm. Plus, I said this before, nothing against Tom Davis, but he's 27, and for him, I think he's got to move on. He's got to go. There is a first team player in there at either League One or League Two standard, and he started less games in his career than Tom Bayliss, or they've started a similar number of games. I think he needs to go somewhere and play first team. I think he'll
I just don't know why it's not here.
Because
he,
I think
there performs, are, doesn't he? He tends to perform quite well.
But the thing is, if he hasn't ever cemented himself as the first choice. And I think we've signed this lad from Ayr, this lad called Rose, and I can't believe from what the stories about him, the thing you hear about him, he's a really good prospect who can play football. And I can't imagine he's going to bring him in and keep him behind Tom Davis. So Tom Davis is going to be behind Dominic Higham and Rose next season?
I think he will. We've got a load of kids that are behind Davis, Williams and Thompson, and
they're 17, 18. Yeah, and they are literally kids. This guy's 22, 23, been playing first team football in Scotland. He will be first choice next season alongside Higham.
Do you reckon?
Yeah, 99.9% convinced. They bought him in early as well. It isn't even like fucked around. You can buy a reserve centre back, not that difficult. They've gone out and they've pinpointed this guy because they obviously have high hopes for him. Mm. So he's going to be first choice, and he's got to be first choice. Mate, you don't take someone off you have that much faith on with 25 minutes to go or 15 minutes to go.
No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is I sort of think I. My worry is that we're going to have to change quite a lot of players this summer in what is otherwise a very high-functioning team, or quite a high-functioning team. And that I think I would suggest that success will be based upon trying to keep as many existing components of it that we possibly can. And I think that changing up the centre-back partnership in a team where you're already going to have to put a new right-back in and a new right midfielder and a new keeper, hopefully a new striker, is going to be, it's a lot of upheaval, isn't it? And I sort of think, do you need to change Tom Davis out? Is he what has contributed to us like not being in the playoffs this season? I would say probably not. I think he's a pretty functional player. I would prefer to see, and this is mad because of how many goals we concede from set pieces, which you have to think is largely the centre-back's fault, but I would have said I could live with them two being first choice centre backs this next season, and then you've got all the kids swarming around ready to take their place if anything goes wrong. A little bit like when Higham came in and we've got Concrete Rod and Willis and whatever else. But there you go. I think that's enough Portsmouth chat anyway, unless you've got any final thoughts, Neil.
No.
There we go. Right, so let's pipe some Dom in, and then maybe we just wrap things up, actually. Yeah, we'll do that. Okay, so. Hi, Dom. Thanks for joining us.
As ever, good to be on the show.
So, a home game against 17th in the league. What could possibly go wrong?
Yeah, well, I mean, that's been a constant refrain during the season, and we never seem to learn. So, Shrewsbury Town, who are pretty much safe, but largely by virtue that they've got a 5 better goal difference than the teams around them, and they're also playing on the final day against Walsall, who are pretty much relegated at this point. So you'd imagine that if they don't win this game or get a thing out of it, they'll probably beat Walsall, and even then they might already have the points to stay up. So yeah, pretty much safe in a season which hasn't gone well, but could probably be predicted when they lost the playoff final, lost about half the team, lost the manager. So it's sort of been par for them this season. They went through two managers. They had John Askey at the start of the season, who, in fairness, signed some pretty good players for them, but never seemed to quite get a tune out of that squad. He was dispensed pretty quickly. And then they took the decision to appoint Sam Ricketts, which was a pretty bold decision, given that Ricketts' previous managerial experience had amounted to less than 6 months at Wrexham, where he was doing okay, but not absolutely spectacularly. So it was a bit of a strange appointment. He hasn't seemed to have quite won over the fans yet. He seems to have Tony Mowbray's habit of just constantly tweaking with the team. Just no matter what the previous result performance was like, he'll make at least two or three changes, and that seems to be rubbing fans up the wrong way. But he's done enough.
Clearly, yeah. And players-wise, who should we be on the lookout for? Start off with Bright Enabakari's brother, as I thought he was for much of the season.
What, just because, yeah, they're complicated?
For some reason, I just thought they'd got the same surname. And then when I saw his name written down, I was like, that's actually entirely different. It's my own downfall there, I think.
Yeah, I suppose phonetically, quite close, Akenabire and Enabakari. Hmm. That's more understandable than when you see them written down.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. That was where it fell apart, clearly. But he's their top scorer, isn't he?
Yeah, in all competitions. He's had a bit of a patchy season, but he's been one of the John Askey signings who, from non-league, has stepped up really well. Somewhere between a forward and a winger, sort of somewhere between one of those two positions. Went on a really big hot streak over December, November. Has dropped out of form a little bit, but is going to be someone who's going to be very big for them next season. They also called upon Tyrese, son of Kevin Campbell, who is on loan from Stoke City, and scored some absolutely excellent goals. He just looks like a very natural striker, which you probably expect given his dad. And he is probably going to start from them. They're probably going to look to hit us on the counter because they only really need to get a point out of this game. So he's pretty good at running in behind and a natural finisher as well. They've also just today signed Sean Wiley to a new 2-year contract, who's a winger and is absolutely excellent. And I think if he wasn't over the age of 30, he'd be someone that bigger clubs / teams in the Championship would be taking a very keen interest at. Just very good at beating players, very direct, got a good delivery on him. And for someone for quite a long time in his career, was just sort of lost in non-league, sort of bobbing between a few clubs, but then has really found his groove with Shrewsbury over the past couple of years. And that's a big move for them going into next season, keeping him. Then in central midfield, they've got some very good players. They've got Ollie Norburn, who is their top scorer in the league, largely due to penalties. But he's a very good ball-playing midfielder. Again, someone who John Askey picked up from non-league in the summer and has had a very good first season in League One. Alongside him, they've got Greg Doherty, who's a box-to-box midfielder on loan from Rangers, who's had a very good scoring season as well. Dipped out of form a little bit, but scored his first goal on Monday in about 8 games. So he's going to be a threat. And then sitting in front of the defence, they've got Anthony Grant, who is just one of those defensive midfielders who is just very good shithouse kind of player. Just very good at sort of just leaving his foot in, but not making fouls serious enough to earn himself bookings. Although he does get booked reasonably regularly, but he probably should get booked more. And he does love winning a soft free kick for his team. So if Shrewsbury go ahead, he is going to be the source of ire, I would imagine. So those are really the main threats for Shrewsbury. The areas of weakness, probably at the back, they've got Jonathan Mitchell in goal, unknown from Derby County. Had a loan spell in Oxford earlier in the season. And he is not 100% convincing. And if you remember when he played Oxford earlier in the season, he made a little bit of a gaffe in fouling Jordan Shipley for a penalty in that game and has been pretty unconvincing throughout the season. And then at centre-back, they've got Luke Waterfall, who's pretty good in the air, but he's just incredibly slow. And they lost a 2-1 lead against Oxford on Monday with a man advantage just because Luke Waterfall was just incredibly slow. And if we can isolate him one-on-one, then that's probably going to be an area to exploit. Perhaps even play Jordi Hiwula through the middle to get him up against him, unless he's actually played so bad on Monday that Shrewsbury drop him from the side completely. But those are going to be big areas to exploit, running out that defence and trying to get as many shots on goal as possible.
So you're saying that we should go chasing Waterfall?
I'm going to exactly.
I'm not going to ask you for a prediction on the game, but I am going to ask you, do you think are we going up?
I'm going to have to make one of my classic predictions and say, no, I don't think so. Actually, there's a very good predictor website if anyone is up for that kind of thing. I think it's called World Football. If you Google search World Football Predictor, it should be one of the top results. And you can just sort of, you can like predict the games, but then you can also click a button and see how that impacts the league. so you can see all the different possibilities. And earlier today, I was thinking, okay, best case scenario for like the Doncaster results. What else do I think is going to happen? And I've got a feeling that we could well finish above Doncaster, but might not make the playoffs with Peterborough coming in.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everyone seems to forget about Peterborough.
Yeah, conveniently so. Yeah, I was hoping you would say no, just with your past record of predictions. So see you at Wembley.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, right. Cheers, Dom.
All right.
Thanks, Dom. Right, okay. Did anyone see any questions on Twitter that they are desperately keen to get to? Let's have a look to see what we've got. It's a great preparation from me, as usual. Paul, did you see any? They come into you usually, don't they?
I mean, it's normally, if we got a penalty in the last minute against Shrewsbury, who would you want to take it? You know?
Jordan Shipley.
I don't think that's a bad shout.
I trust that left boot with my life.
Yeah, he's a player that strikes me that he would be like, yeah, I'll take it as well. Do you know what I mean? Like, he's a sort of brash character that would just be like, yeah, fuck it, I'll have a go.
We should also quickly mention that as we go to air, that it looks heavily like we will be staying at the Rico next season.
Oh, yeah, that's probably worth us talking about, isn't it? Given that it's, you know, all that has been going around Twitter, isn't it? I guess the thing is that at the moment, what we would be doing, we've been quite good this season, haven't we, for trying not to enter into the realms of, oh, what do we think will happen that we don't know about? So we talked about leaving when it looked pretty concrete that we were leaving. And now, actually, it looks like we might stay. We'll probably talk more about it if it's done. Because we'll probably curse it, won't we? We'll start saying, oh, wow, that was good that we've managed to get back. And then it'll turn out that we're ground sharing with Burton next season. So possibly we just say, actually, we would be desperately happy if a deal was struck because all we want is to be playing back at the Rico next season. Is that fair? Is that what we want?
From me, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. I just realised I was making a big statement there for all of us.
You can do every so often. Okay, just a couple of quick questions. Just one word answer. Would we have finished high if Liam Kelly had played all season?
Possibly. What's the least you can commit to something?
No, okay. Despite his apparent limited technique, has the inclusion of Big Backer Boy aided the likes of Harula and Bright to flourish in a manner akin to Biamu and McNulty last season?
Undoubtedly.
I'd say it's a false equivalency, but yeah, he certainly helped.
Yeah, I would agree with the first bit around has his introduction, irrespective of his own personal qualities, has him being there helped the team? Yeah, without question. Has his outright aggression and movement off the ball and everything been really useful? Yes. Does he look like a footballer when he's got the ball? No.
Who would you rather fight? One Clive Platt-sized Connor Chaplin or 20 Connor Chaplin-sized Clive Platt?
Well, this is absolutely clear, isn't it? I know that this is a joke and it's probably constructed to be that much of a joke, but this is very much, it's the one. There's not enough of a height differential between them to make one fight. Why does it make it balanced? Is that, you know, the 20 the 20 guys are gonna have a field day, even if they are ever so slightly shorter than the average male.
Slightly. Sorry, there was a question. If next season you could have Bright, Bayliss or Willis. Oh, Daryl Moxon, if you could keep only one of Willis, Bright or Bayliss, which one? And why? But you don't have to give why, just which one?
Bayliss for me, because I'll say why, because he is ours.
Yeah, I sort of think it would be a toss-up. Sorry, Jordan Willis, but it would be a toss-up between Enabakari and Bayliss, because I don't think those players are so easily replaceable. I would, even though Enabakari's probably had more of an overall impact this season, Tom Bayliss is my player. I fucking love Tom Bayliss. He's exactly what I want my team to look like. All aggressive and lanky and work like sort of asymmetrical and yet strangely boring haircut. Like he's had it cut, like he cuts it himself. Yeah, he's completely for me, Tom Bayliss.
What about you, Paul?
I'm going to be sort of my usual control.
You're going to say Willis.
No, God, no. I think your average centre half can be replaced pretty easily, as I said earlier. I'd probably go for Bright, as much as it might surprise you. I just think if you're going to play this 4-2-3-1, I think you could probably get away with a Shipley or a Westbrook alongside Kelly. But I think the number 10, when we played it earlier in the season and we had Chaplin there, it just, for me, it didn't work. And I think if you're going to sort of do that role, your number 10 is so pivotal to the way you play.
Yeah.
And they've got to, and they've got to be able to do the things that he can do. And as I said, I don't think he's... My issues with him at home, you watch the goals that he's scored and set up away from home, they are all the sort of... They're the sort of thing you want from him, where he's beaten a man and then he's played the ball through. They're good three balls. It's a good free ball to Huila. It's a good free ball to Huila where he scores against Sunderland. He can drift past players, which is just a skill that I've never had. Like, I've never been able to skin people. It's something that I've always sort of seen as a bit of a mystery. He does it with the ultimate ease. And I think in this division, if you've got someone like that, then it makes life a lot easier. And I think Bayliss is brilliant. I just think Bayliss, while I think what he brings is difficult to replace, I think in this division you could probably, if you've got Bright instead, but I think if we lost both, I think I'd be slightly more concerned if we didn't replace them with the other player who I'd actually sort of, as much as he does my nut in, I actually think that Luke Thomas would be a better number 10 than he is winger. I think the ball he played through for Bakayoko's goal against Sunderland was sort of taught down, wasn't mentioned enough. That was a great pass. He saw the highlights of the Bradford game. He played a really good ball through. I think his passing of that ball is probably better than his end product in out wide. I think he could make a pretty decent number 10.
Any final thoughts of any description, or are we wrapping things up?
It'd just be interesting to see how sad or happy we are this time next week.
Quite, and we will bring you that reaction such as it will be next week. Right, thanks, Paul.
All right, cheers, mate.
And thanks, Neil.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening. Bye.